Over 150 years ago, Confederate General Robert E. Lee surrendered the Army of Northern Virginia to the Union at Appomattox Courthouse, effectively ending the American Civil War. The Confederate States of America dissolved not long after, and the American South was once again brought under the jurisdiction of the United States government. You might think that a 150-year-old conflict wouldn't be a source of cultural tension today, and until relatively recently, that was the case. The United States has, for over a century, gone out of its way to honor the Confederate dead, whether it be granting citizenship to the late Robert E. Lee, or granting the families of fallen Confederate soldiers the same benefits as U.S. veterans. This was normal as late as the early 2000s. However, in recent years, the American Civil War has re-entered the political landscape in a big way. This has come in the form of attempts to remove Confederate monuments from the public square. In many cases, these monuments have stood without issue for over 100 years. It seems strange that there is more hatred towards Confederates today than there was in the post-war period, including from people who had literally fought against them. The source of this renewed hostility is obvious: changing demographics and culture in the United States. As white Americans move towards becoming a minority due to mass immigration from the entire world, respect for white American history is also being ousted. Confederates are the first targets in the crosshairs. Due to their direct association with slavery, they're soft targets for attack indeed, as many people would rather throw their hands up in submission than defend these controversial figures. However, I'm not the type to surrender so easily. That brings us to the subject at hand. One advocate for removing Confederate monuments is the self-proclaimed history channel Atun-Shei Films. This channel devotes a large amount of focus to the Confederacy, primarily working to demonize them. At the start of the George Floyd riots this summer, the channel released a video titled "You're Probably Wrong About Confederate Monuments," where the creator puts forward perhaps the strongest arguments that anti-monument advocates have.
If you've seen many of my videos, it'll come as no surprise to you that I'm in favor of removing Confederate monuments from public spaces.
So to rebut the pro-removal movement, I'll be providing counter-arguments to their strongest points. So let's dive in. His video begins with a rather bizarre explanation for how he supposedly went from being for keeping monuments to now being for removing them.
I used to be pretty staunchly opposed to the removal of Confederate statues, but living through the monument controversy here in New Orleans in 2017 changed my opinion. It's one thing to have a political opinion in the abstract. It's quite another to be heading home from work one evening and get caught in the middle of a huge street brawl between two groups of protesters.
This is all he says in regards to his change. It's rather unclear why two sides brawling over a monument would make you change your opinion about keeping one. While it does demonstrate there are those passionate for removal, it equally shows there are those passionate for protection. It's interesting that he calls pro-monument groups out-of-town agitators and anti-monument groups locals, because this statement is hardly backed by evidence. One of the most influential groups pushing for Confederate monuments to be removed is Black Lives Matter. This group has a tremendous amount of nationwide funding and influence. They use this funding and influence to organize many anti-Confederate protests throughout the country. If there were indeed out-of-town agitators in Atun-Shei Films' hometown, they were, at best, on both sides. I also want to quickly address the thumbnail of his video. Flipping off the bust of a person who's been dead over 100 years? Stunning and brave, we're all very impressed. Now let's get to his arguments, which he presents by responding to pro-monument arguments.
Removing Confederate monuments is a slippery slope. What's next? Removing statues of Washington and Jefferson just because they owned slaves?
This argument is predicated on two assumptions. The first one is that as of early June 2020, the removal of Confederate statues has been a widespread phenomenon. This is demonstrably false. This map shows the location of all Confederate symbols standing before 2015 across the United States. Let's see how many monuments were removed in the Great Purge of the last 5 years. Oh. Oh. Seems most of the monuments glorifying the Confederacy are still standing. Not exactly a coordinated and conspiratorial campaign to scrub America clean of its Confederate history.
So here Atun-Shei Films argues that so many Confederate monuments still standing shows that this can't possibly be some widespread phenomenon. But this is a silly point. These monuments are still only standing because so many people oppose their removal. if it were up to someone like Atun-Shei Films and those similar in thought, all of these monuments would be removed. This is nothing more than demonstrating his own side's failure in accomplishing its goals in many places. But they continue to push, which is why this rebuttal is necessary. He then makes another point about why he thinks removing Confederate monuments can't possibly be a coordinated effort.
The second thing that it's predicated on is the idea that the impetus behind removing Confederate statues comes from the top down. But it's also not a directive from the Democratic establishment or coastal elitists or whatever. The calls to remove Confederate statues in the South have been overwhelmingly local, grassroots efforts. The order to remove four Confederate statues here in New Orleans was the result of a city council vote. Old Joe, the Confederate statue in Gainesville, Florida, was removed by order of the county commissioner.
He goes on to give several other examples of monuments being removed by local officials. This point falls flat for several reasons. Firstly, to suggest that something happening locally can't be part of a coordinated top-down effort is simply ridiculous. We live in the information age. Propaganda is distributed to the population en masse via the internet, television, mandatory schooling, etc. The corporate media, or mainstream media, is especially effective at forming public opinion. Indeed, one of the very reasons that people want to tear Confederate monuments down is due to the messages being given by the mainstream media. If not for this media, this entire controversy would be far less significant. Furthermore, there's nothing stopping local officials from receiving marching orders from a higher authority. Elected officials are part of political parties, and political parties coordinate. They also have donors and special interests who they work to please. To put it plainly, the idea that people now want to remove Confederate monuments out of some new organic, grassroots awakening is the furthest thing from the truth.
But more to your point, are Washington and Jefferson really next? Well, it is true that some people on the left have called for the removal of monuments to the slave-owning founding fathers. But among Democrats, it remains a very, very fringe opinion.
Imagine the Titanic hitting an iceberg. One crewmate screams, "We're going to sink! We need to act now!" And another replies to that with, "Actually, the ship hasn't filled with water yet, so there's nothing to worry about." The fault in the logic here is obvious. Events have consequences. You don't start tearing down statues of historical figures en masse on shaky, controversial pretenses and not have it have a ripple effect that extends to other historical figures. The reason these statues are under attack isn't simply because they were Confederates. It's that they were white people who put their own race first. This doesn't stop at the Confederates. They're simply a rung on the entire ladder being climbed by anti-white sentiment. As it so happens, not long after Atun-Shei released his video, statues to George Washington, Ulysses S. Grant, Teddy Roosevelt, and a few other American historical figures were destroyed or removed. This was so embarrassing for his argument that he actually had to address it in a pinned comment to his video. In the comment, he proclaims that he's actually fine with those statues being removed. He thus abandoned the very point he made here, and the slippery slope argument is once again proven right.
Removing Confederate monuments is tantamount to erasing history. We can't erase history just because some people find it offensive.
The people who put up the majority of Confederate monuments are directly responsible for propagating the misinformation and outright fabrication that has, for 150 years, given white Americans a rosy, happy, sunshine and puppies view of the Confederacy. Many of you seem to be under the impression that the Lost Cause myth is not a myth, that it's a legitimate historical interpretation. The Civil War from the Southern point of view. I'm sorry to say that's just not the case. The tenets of the Lost Cause obfuscate and twist the truth, and the development of the myth is extremely well documented.
So here he's invoking the Lost Cause narrative, a narrative that he and several other historians consider a historical campaign to whitewash the Confederacy. But when analyzing this supposed narrative that Atun-Shei states is well documented, we immediately run into problems. What counts as whitewashing the Confederacy? Is it something as simple as not portraying them as evil mustache-twirling villains? Is it whitewashing to say that any of their viewpoints were justified? Is it whitewashing to accurately attribute the causes of the war to not just slavery, but a variety of issues, including federal tariffs on goods that were critical to the Southern economy? Keep in mind that the South at the time had the fourth largest economy in the world. While slavery was certainly a key issue in this rivalry, it was not the only issue, and other factors should not be overlooked or downplayed. The Confederates saw their states as part of the Union conditionally, the condition being that they feel adequately represented in the federal government. By the time of the Civil War, they had all concluded this condition was broken, and they resolved to end their involvement in the United States as a result. This brought up a constitutional issue that still, to this very day, has not been fully resolved. Was the United States intended to keep states that joined it within it forever? The Confederates said no, the Union said yes, and this was the true cause of the war. Armies weren't mustered to invade the South over Southern states owning slaves. They were done so over Southern states seceding. This is indisputable fact, not a myth. What people like Atun-Shei films call the Lost Cause myth is so broad it could encompass essentially any unbiased review of the Civil War. He wants to replace non-existent propaganda with his propaganda.
It began as a post-war effort to try and justify secession, typified by the memoirs of men like Jubal Early and Jefferson Davis. Publications like the Southern Historical Society papers whitewashed the brutality of slavery and minimized its role in starting the Civil War. And then, of course, there is the Edward A. Pollard book titled The Lost Cause, which was incredibly influential. It's often described as a history book, just kind of, again, history from the Southern point of view, but it's little more than a pro-Confederate editorial.
Atun-Shei Films never actually goes into detail about what the Lost Cause actually means. He states the Southern Historical Society papers whitewash slavery, but no further detail is given. He draws zero distinction between what constitutes a legitimate historical account of the Civil War from the Confederate perspective and a, as he puts it, pro-Confederate editorial. Like many who harp about a supposed Lost Cause narrative being spread, he is vague on purpose. To people like Atun-Shei Films, any historical review of the Civil War that doesn't paint Confederates as mindless monsters is pro-Confederate propaganda. But the inverse is true. To oversimplify the Confederate point of view is the fabrication. Let's move to his next point, where he claims that the true intention behind Confederate monuments was to intimidate black people.
It's important to understand that this effort didn't come out of a vacuum. Ex-Confederates didn't just want to polish their reputations. They also wanted to reverse the effects of the war through political agitation. The 13th Amendment abolished slavery. The 14th granted black Americans citizenship. The 15th protected the voting rights of black men. If the plantation class, who had enjoyed unparalleled supremacy across the South before the war, didn't fight these measures, then they would lose their political grip on that region for good. So they fought tooth and nail, using every tactic in the book. Confederate memorial associations never explicitly stated that the purpose of their monuments was to intimidate black people, or to celebrate the planter class's reascension to political power after Reconstruction. But given their ringing endorsements of racial violence and oppression, there can be little doubt that this was the case.
This is pure speculation and has very little to do with what the people who dedicated the monuments actually said. These groups gave many different reasons for erecting the monuments, and not one stated reason had anything to do with intimidating anyone. And here's why. The true purpose behind most Confederate monuments was Southern pride. Pride, respect, and kinship with a unique Southern people that developed over centuries. Not anti-blackness, not being pro-slavery, not being anti-American, but to be pro-South. This is obvious upon listening to any of the many different dedication speeches for these monuments. The speeches focus on the honor, sacrifice, and moral character of Southern soldiers and leaders. I'll be giving an example of one of these speeches at the end of the video. You see, in the past, your value as a person wasn't determined by how anti-racist or anti-sexist you were. It was determined by one's virtues and duty to their people. Confederates like Robert E. Lee are honored for their duty to the South, and also, in the case of Lee, for his impeccable personal character. Racism today is effectively a smear word, used especially against white people who care about their own race. That was certainly the case for people who built Confederate statues. But of course, it was also the case for the people who built the United States itself. Even the Union that fought against the Confederacy would today be considered racist, as many of their plans for freed slaves was to send them back to Africa. This policy was known as repatriation. The last thing I'll say on this is that those tearing down Confederate monuments make zero distinction between what they believe the intentions of the statues was. Take, for example, Silent Sam, torn down by a mob in 2017. This statue was simply dedicated to the nameless Confederate war dead and had nothing to do with glorifying slavery. Did that matter to the mob that tore it down? No. Because, like most lobbying to tear down monuments, they're animated by anti-white animus, not some nuanced historical viewpoint.
We're not erasing history by taking down Confederate monuments. We're course-correcting against openly racist, demonstrably false political propaganda that has dominated American historiography for far too long.
Like I said, for those like Atun-Shei Films, this is not about erasing history, it's about rewriting it from their viewpoint.
I'll grant you that the Confederates fought for an unjust cause, but keeping their monuments in place reminds us of that dark period in American history. Those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it.
This is actually not an argument I would make, as it actually plays right into the pro-removal narrative. While monuments should be used to help people remember their history, those in favor of removal want them specifically remembered in as negative a light as possible. Two very different things.
The only people these days who propose to do anything with these statues to promote historical education are in my camp, not yours. Among the anti-monument crowd, the overwhelming consensus is that they belong in a museum.
When someone like Atun-Shei Films suggests moving these monuments to museums, what they're actually imagining is essentially a tightly controlled public pillory, one where Confederates can be totally demonized and have their worst aspects highlighted. A public monument leaves historical interpretation up for the viewer to decide for themselves. Museums, by contrast, tell viewers exactly how to think. And boy, do the pro-removal crowd want to tell people how to think about white people and American history. Atun-Shei Films actually directly confirms this himself a few sentences later.
Maybe we should take the most famous ones and place them in a new museum, dedicated to American slavery and black oppression. It could be a sobering experience, putting these statues in a different context.
He then moves on to his final argument.
Confederate soldiers were American soldiers. Whatever evil they did, they still deserve to be honored for their service and sacrifice.
Do they, though?
Yes.
Confederates were Americans. But they didn't fight for America. They fought to destroy American democracy. The United States was founded on principles of the Enlightenment, liberal democracy, personal liberty, equality for all, even if, for a lot of Americans, those ideals were and are a sick joke.
Well, so which is it? Does America value democracy or does it not? This guy is talking out of both sides of his mouth. In reality, the true principle that America was founded upon was self-government, something the Confederacy was attempting to do. This is precisely why the Confederates saw themselves as the true Americans.
The Confederacy didn't stand for American values. It stood for might makes right. When America is its best self, we consistently deplore the ideology of might makes right.
Someone should probably let Atun-Shei Films know that the United States was born from a revolution. How was what the Confederacy did might makes right, but not what the United States did during its founding? The truth is, neither are. Both had nuanced moral justifications for what they were doing. No one ever said, we're strong, you're weak, therefore we're right. That is the definition of a straw man argument. The truth is, nothing Atun-Shei Films is saying here is based on fact. This is simply his own modern, personal interpretation of history. And though it should be obvious, don't make the mistake of thinking he's some kind of American nationalist. Just listen to what he says next about United States history.
There's a lot to be ashamed of in American history. Slavery, Native American genocide, the Monroe Doctrine, Manifest Destiny, the Mexican War, Vietnam, Iraq, white supremacy, the list goes on.
I too think there are things that America should be ashamed of, but they're not events from over 100 years ago. There are things that are happening right now, like being the pornography capital of the world, or having hundreds of thousands of abortions every year. It's very, very telling that Atun-Shei Films wants us to focus on slavery, which was ended 150 years ago. This is what happens when the only basis of your worldview is being anti-white. Let's get to the final part of the video, where he chastises historians for not being anti-racist enough and not more strongly enforcing his anti-white version of history.
Now look, taking these statues down isn't going to magically solve racism. No one thing ever will. But does that mean that we, as historians and students of history, shouldn't even try? Taking a look, a honest look at darker aspects of our past can inform us about things that we're dealing with today. It's easy to talk about how the Battle of Waterloo or the 30 Years' War shaped the modern world. It's a lot less comfortable and more challenging to talk about how slavery or indigenous genocide did, but that's a much more productive conversation to have. Get out of your comfort zone, history nerds.
I don't know where this guy has been for the last 60 years, but the American university system is already dominated by people with exactly the worldview he is espousing. There are entire college majors for indigenous studies, genocide studies, and critical race theory. And everything we are seeing today are the effects of this. Contrary to being productive, Atun-Shei Films' view that we should connect all racial problems today back to slavery is destructive. It creates a framework where white people are seen as the villains of history, which modern white people should be ashamed of, and other groups are encouraged to get even with. Where this anti-European narrative is leading and has led in the past is dangerous. And we should ask ourselves if Atun-Shei Films and the academics that agree with him want it that way. Now to give some closing thoughts. There may be some who say that monuments aren't important or aren't worth fighting for, but they are. Monuments are part of a people's understanding of themselves. They tie present generations to the past in a unique way. If these symbols weren't important, they wouldn't be under threat of removal. And while we should do what we can to protect these symbols, we should not allow those that are removed to break our spirit. Instead, it should be the fire that makes us work even harder. I'll now read an excerpt from a speech that truly encapsulates why Confederate monuments were built and why they should continue to stand. The speech is the 1890 dedication to the Robert E. Lee Monument in Richmond, Virginia, and it concludes as thus. For all the stupendous wealth and power, which in the last 30 years have lifted these states to foremost rank among the nations of the earth, are less a subject for pride than this one heroic man, this human product of our country and its institutions. Let this monument, then, teach to generations yet unborn these lessons of his life. Let it stand not as a record to civil strife, but as a perpetual protest against whatever is low and sordid in our public and private lives. Let it stand as a memorial of personal honor that never brooked a stain, of knightly valor without thought of self, of far-reaching military genius unsoiled by ambition, of heroic constancy from which no cloud of misfortune could ever hide the path of duty. Let it stand for reproof and censure if our people should ever sink below the standards of their fathers. Let it stand as the embodiment of a brave and virtuous people's ideal leader. Let it stand as a great public act of thanksgiving and praise, for that it pleased Almighty God to bestow upon these southern states a man so formed to reflect his attributes of power, majesty, and goodness.